Good evening, everyone. I am Giancarlo Guerrero, music director of the Nashville Symphony. Tonight, we are going to explore one of the most revolutionary pieces of music that has ever been written, the Symphony No. 3 of Beethoven, also known as the Eroica. In many ways, this is a work that almost signals the end of the classical period of Mozart and Haydn, and even going backward, even further back with the music of Bach, and created this new way of composition that Beethoven was truly exploring in this work. And we do think that this is the beginning of what will become the Romantic period of the 19th century. The earliest sketches of the Third Symphony were probably written in the summer or fall of 1802, but Beethoven did most of the work on the Symphony of 1803, completing the score in 1804. The composer himself conducted the first public performance in Vienna on April 7, 1805. In 1804, Napoleon had himself crowned emperor. He had been acceptable to Beethoven as a military dictator, long as he called himself first consul. But now, the disappointed and angry composer scratched the words intitolatate, which means titled Bonaparte, on the first page of his newly completed Third Symphony. The erasure, which was accomplished with a knife, was so violent that it left a hole in the paper. You can actually see this in one of the museums in Vienna. The first printing of this symphony had the title Sinfonia Eroica, a heroic symphony composed to celebrate the memory of a great man. One of the most famous anecdotes from the premiere tells of an audience member yelling out, "I will pay another kreutzer if this thing will only stop." The press reviews were also not very positive. Some writers felt the work lost itself in lawlessness, that this composition had too many glaring and bizarre effects, which made it so difficult to understand and to comprehend the entire work. One critic actually wrote, "The public and Herr van Beethoven, who conducted, were not satisfied with each other on this evening. The public thought the symphony was too heavy, too long, and himself too rude because he did not take his bow in recognition of applause, which came from a very small portion of the audience." For his part, Beethoven found that the applause was not strong. Beethoven had given his public plenty to be upset about, a symphony twice as long as anyone in the audience had ever heard before. One that was unprecedented in its demand on orchestral virtuosity. Demands that were certainly inadequately met. Unprecedented as well, the complexity of weirdness of details, like the wrong horn entrance in the first movement. Don't worry, more on that later. On the other hand, all of the reviewers seem to agree that the best piece on that concert was another E-flat major symphony by a man called Anton Eberle, who was also receiving the premiere that evening. We get the first sign of trouble at the very, very beginning of the piece. Beethoven doesn't give us the expected introduction. Instead, the Eroica begins with two very forceful chords of E-flat major, whack, whack. They set the key and the tempo, as well as giving us an idea of the character of the music. The cellos give us the first theme of the exposition, which is nothing more than an E-flat chord tipped on its side. The agitated syncopations in the violin provide a sense of danger. Less than 10 seconds into the work, the main key of E-flat gets completely derailed, and Beethoven takes us on a short but wild ride through many, many different distant harmonies. Beethoven quickly returns to the original key with a heroic presentation of the cello theme. This is, after all, the beginning of the piece. But although we return to safe harmonic territory, something has already happened. Our sense of consonance and home is no longer for sure. And this dramatic intrusion of dissonance and ambiguity so early in the game is a clue that the horizons will be so broad and that the complex events lie ahead. For a few moments, everything proceeds calmly as the cello melody spreads through the orchestra and is beautifully expanded. But almost immediately, Having already disturbed melodic and harmonic regularities, Beethoven now messes with the rhythm with explosive offbeat accents that superimpose a two-beat pattern onto a 3-4 measure. This early in the game, we're not even 1 minute into the symphony, and we already lost our sense of gravity when it comes to harmonies and rhythm. As we continue to listen, notice that there is a seeming contradiction. The music moves at a very high speed, but then again, it feels rather unhurried. Many diverse musical characters pass in front of us. The symphony's first theme was literally down to earth because of its steady downbeats, but the new second theme now presents a completely different sort of rhythmic pattern. A long series of upbeats lead to a crest on what would normally be a weak third beat. When the phrase is repeated, the accompaniment adds new complications of its own, and it all dissolves in a series of weaker afterbeats. Once again, we lose our sense of gravity. The music gathers new energy, but again, Beethoven introduces his offbeat accents and finally disrupts the motif completely with a fierce sequence of sharply emphatic chords, separated silences, and they're dissonant enough to make even more telling the effect of their metrical displacement. This disruption nicely allows our sure feeling that we know where we're going, and so the exposition ends in a mix of firmness and uncertainty. The beginning of the development section is hushed, but is hardly quiet. Harmonically, the music is in a big state of unrest, and a growing density of melodic material adds to our sense of agitation. Familiar ideas are so transformed that they sound like new themes. This development has enormous sweeps and it is also more than half as long as the exposition. It is impossible to stop as when you listen to this music. And I wanted for you to listen to most of the development section. The development section still goes on for a little while longer, but I think you very clearly hear all of these different ideas that are literally one on top of the other. And that was really Beethoven's genius. He would grab a 2-3 note motif, something so simple, and yet be able to transform it in every imaginable mathematical way. And he makes it seem so easy. At the end of the development, three things now happen at the same time. The harmonic changes are now slowed down. The action at the top speeds up, and the dynamic level goes wildly from fortissimo to pianissimo. The procedure is agonizingly slow, the music on the edge of inaudible. All of this generates a feeling of suspense. We are on the very footsteps of home. The violins are now trembling very softly. And then a lone horn player, as though unable to bear the waiting any longer, sounds the first note of the principal theme of the opening. What has happened is that the horn has begun the recapitulation while the strings were still preparing for it. Another anecdote at the rehearsal is one that one of Beethoven's brightest students was sitting with the composer, and he got up and exclaimed in anger that the horn player made a huge mistake. Beethoven, of course, corrected him right away by assuring him that this was indeed what he had intended. This false entrance seemed to awaken the whole orchestra, and we find ourselves in the recapitulation. Thank you. I am sure you were able to listen and hear that horn player. It does sound like a mistake, but it is incredibly brilliant because it almost gives away what is coming up next. Beethoven's entrance into the final section of the movement is an amazing moment within an amazing symphony. The recapitulation has done its job of reestablishing the main key of E flat major. The coda begins with a quietly confident statement of the opening theme. At this point, the composer hushes the music down to pianissimo and then simply picks up the same melody, but this time, forte, in the very remote key of D flat major. Once again, he picks up the phrase very boldly, but this time setting it down in the completely unrelated key of C major and with a very aggressive character. Once again, we lose our sense of harmony and our sense of gravity. In just about 8 seconds, he completely destroys the harmonic structural work of the entire movement. Now, the task of the coda is to undo the damage it has brought itself and to get back to the main harmonic key. Beethoven, of course, accomplishes this with great elegance and perfect timing.
Thank you.
And can you believe that this is just the end of the first movement? This first movement is longer than some complete symphonies that were written at the time. No wonder the audience started getting restless, and no wonder people started wondering whether this was some sort of a joke. This was beyond anything that they had ever seen. So in this first movement, Beethoven is already laying down new rules that in many ways, probably the audiences were just not ready to take on. Next comes a funeral march for the hero whom we have probably forgotten in the musical excitement of the first movement. It begins very softly in the strings, but the instrumental color that really jumps out is that of the oboe, which is a good instrument for mourning. Its first solo is accompanied by a very noticeable funeral drumming figure in the strings. Beethoven lays this music out on the grandest possible scale, and in doing so, provides bold departures and shifts of tone. The first of these is a section in C major that contains within itself the contrast of the gentle beginning and heroic drums climaxes. Hey, Justin, let me skip the next cue, okay?
No problem. So go to.
So let's go now to the one that begins at the end, okay?
Sounds good.
All right. At the end of the movement, we get the most radical touch of all, one probably incomprehensible to most people at the first performance. Beethoven returns to the funeral theme he had used at the beginning of the movement. But this time, the line starts to break apart, sobbing, stammering, and disintegrating. We can still make out the theme, even though it is still played very soft, but we hear it a few notes at a time, with more pauses in between. At the end, over a final drumming in the cellos and basses, the woodwinds utter a last despairing cry. The third movement scherzo is full of kinetic energy, an impression that is reinforced by having the orchestra played incredibly soft. Beethoven is very specific about asking the players to resist getting loud, even as more players join in. It keeps you on the edge of your seats until finally, in less than 1 second, the entire orchestra explodes in a joyful presentation of the opening theme. I should have mentioned that the symphony calls for 3 horn players. The standard size of the horn section in the orchestra at the time was usually just 2 horns. So we can already see that Beethoven is starting to expand the size of the orchestra and the size of the ensemble for future generations. The middle trio section is a virtuoso turn for the horn section. It is time to go hunting. Thank you. Beethoven gives us one last startling surprise by shifting the center of gravity from the first movement to the last. This is a creative and psychological innovation that the composer will fully develop in his fifth and his ninth symphony. It should be noted that the Eroica is not an absolutely radical departure in this respect. As I mentioned last week, Beethoven had already made a powerful move in this direction in the second symphony. But even though this is a radical new work, for the finale of the Eroica, Beethoven turns to an old musical compositional style, the very popular theme and variations. It is a simple formula that presents a small melody that goes through many different transformations. For the main theme, Beethoven recycles a melody that he had actually used three times before. The beginning of the movement provides a powerful introduction with wild scales going up and down until it comes to a complete stop. The plucked strings give us a hushed and mysterious presentation of the main theme that will undergo many different variations. Listen very closely and see if you can still hear the main melody as it goes through many different personalities. True to classical traditions for variations, Beethoven slows the tempo near the end. This final slow variation presents a lovely lyrical character, but we eventually realize that here, Beethoven gives us a climax of towering force. After reaching the top, Beethoven carefully dismantles this structure. The music is almost an echo of the disintegration at the end of the funeral march. And then, without any warning, he picks up the fast tempo again. And in fact, this is a quasi-variation of the initial introduction of the movement. To close, he fulfills his heroic symphony with triumphant and affirmative noise. This symphony may have been too much for the audiences of the day. And yet here in the 21st century, we appreciate it as one of the great masterpieces in the history of music. Beethoven himself came to realize that he may have gone too far in pushing the audience's expectations with a symphony like this. So much so that the fourth symphony, he takes a step back. Next week, we're going to explore the next symphony, number four, where you will see that Beethoven almost second guesses himself and tries to recover and go back to some of the ideas that Mozart and Haydn had laid forth. But it's not going to last very long, because after the fourth comes the mighty fifth symphony of Beethoven, which we'll also explore in a couple of weeks. So thank you again for joining us this evening, and stay safe. Bye-bye.